First of all, I would like to acknowledge that we are on the traditional territories of the Santi and the Esquimalt First Nations here in Vancouver Island. And this is very meaningful for me because where I work, having founded 8 years ago, a non-profit organization in a town very close to Tarapoto in the upper Amazon, the upper Peruvian Amazon. And I collaborate with the largest indigenous group there, the Quechua Lamistas. But I have been going there for many more years, collaborating with NGOs, having been invited by Peruvian NGO to go there. So I also, so I'm hoping that one day we could have an exchange of some of my Quechua friends in Lamas and various Salish communities here. That would be a dream for me. So if we are to adopt this pre-Columbian technology, recommencing a process catastrophically interrupted 500 years ago, it behooves us to listen to the wisdom of these people, who, unique among all the civilizations of history, left their land more fertile than when they first inhabited it. After all, Europe's cradle of civilization, the Fertile Crescent, is now an arid desert. What sort of cosmovision led to the discovery and ingenious deployment of biochar to create Terra Preta? For the Quechua Lamistas and indigenous peoples everywhere, the earth, the cosmos, is alive and sentient like humans. It possesses agency. Famously, the Lakota people of North America begin their invocations and prayers with the phrase, "All my relations," and often follow this with a long invocation of many animals, plants, and other beings of the world. For the Quechua Lamistas, the spirits of the chakra, the food field, Mama Achpa, the soil, Pachamama, the earth, Mama Quilla, the moon, Yakumama, the water, the rain, Sachamama, the forest, after which I named my center, and Taita Inti, the sun, among others, are addressed by kin terms. They are thus, as in the case of the Lakotas and other North American indigenous people and First Nations in Canada, seen as part of their relations, their kin group. The humans invoking them as relations express simultaneously that they themselves are part of the earth, part of the cosmos, and that they are nurtured, kept alive by those non-human kin spirits. Indeed, the kin terms of Mama and Taita refer to a parental or grandparental generation, making it clear that the humans addressing the beings of the earth or cosmos in that manner place themselves in the role of the child receiving nurturance. However, the ritual gestures and invocations express not only gratitude toward the nurturing received, but also the intent to reciprocally nurture the spirits. Perhaps a better way of saying this might be that those gestures unfold an awareness of mutual nurturance. Humans are cared for, kept alive by their non-human relatives, and in return, they care for and keep these non-human relatives in a healthy or harmonious state. This practice of mutual nurturance between humans and the natural world through ritual gestures implicitly recognizes that we humans live thanks to the products of the soil, the water, the sun, the moon, the forest, the air, among many others. This awareness generates this, the desire to reciprocate and endeavor in return to care for that world on which all humans depend. To label such practices as anthropomorphizing the non-human world, namely projecting onto it characteristics of the human world, is to suppress our awareness of our real dependence on the non-human world and at the same time our responsibility towards it. Such labeling, such ways of understanding these practices are problematic in that they tend to make invisible to us our profound dependence on the non-human world, as well as our responsibility towards it. Especially since the scientific revolution, this new modern Western way of understanding nature was explicitly recognized as giving power and control over it. We modern people often think of ourselves with pride as being able to control the forces, the blind forces of nature, the latter being seen as blind and lacking agency. The indigenous view is very different. It is one of co-nurturance, even co-creation, between humans and the non-human world. The example of Pre-Columbian Terra Preta in the Amazon basin is a stunning example of co-creation between the two. The pre-Columbian Amerindians did not so much attempt to control nature as to co-create with her, in keeping with the view of the famous Harvard biologist Richard Lewontin, who stated that organism and environment co-create each other. This asymmetry between modern and indigenous views might be illustrated by what two environmental biologists, John Vandenmeer and Yvette Perfecto, who teach at Michigan University, write about the effect of ceramic shards on the fertility of soils. So I will just put a different picture. This is our ecological pool at my center. This is a nice picture too. So on page 35 of their book, Breakfast for Biodiversity, 1995, there's an illustration and explanation of the role that such ceramic shards play in increasing the fertility of soils. And I should add that all Terra Preta soil, pre-Columbian Terra Preta soil found by archaeologists, is absolutely full of broken shards, ceramic shards. These authors explain that there are oppositely charged ions on the shards and the roots of plants. These oppositely charged ions permit a greater intake of nutrients by the roots of plants. Such information can be verified and is clearly true as well as useful. It is what modern Western science does and does very well. It is clearly quite possible that the indigenous makers of Terra Preta, creators of Terra Preta, recognize that ceramic shards increase the fertility of the soil and thus continue to use them. It is equally plausible that they offer to Mother Earth pieces of broken ceramics in the same way as when, at the death of a woman, they broke the ceramics she made and placed them in her place of burial. Women are the ceramicists throughout South America. Pre-Columbian Amerindians interred their dead, and women, being the ceramicists, broke her ceramics, a gesture unfolding the message that, like her, her ceramics have come to an end. The woman's body, along with her ceramics, made of earth, returned as dead matter to where they came from, the soil. And the earth, the soil, is also where new life sprouts from. Degeneration, decomposition, and death are what make new life possible. It is not far-fetched to imagine that the pre-Columbian Amazonians were aware of the role of decomposition, degeneration, and death in general in the processes that create Terra Preta. Microorganisms can be recognized by their white or orange color, and whether they were seeded intentionally in this soil or not by its makers, their work of decomposing matter and making it available to the growth, for the growth of plants is widely known by indigenous and peasant farmers. The manure pile in front of the farmer's house used to be the pride of French peasants, now a vanishing greed, as you know. In coastal Orissa, India, where I did ethnographic fieldwork among peasants earlier, the manured pile outside the house is also treasured as the source of their field's fertility. The view of seeing broken ceramics as signifying the end, as it were, death of an earthenware is further strengthened by the fact that they are interred along with its creator. Thus, the ritual practice of breaking ceramics after offering their content to the spirits of the food field is a gesture echoing one at the time of death. This gesture is one that partakes of the recognized significance of decomposition and death in the creation of new life. What can we learn from a close examination of these two cultural perspectives, the indigenous one and the Western scientific one? Putting these ritual practices alongside the scientific findings of Vandermeer and Perfecto on the role of ceramic shards in increasing the fertility of soil, we can see that they exemplify different ways of approaching the same topic, ceramic shards. In the scientific case, the ceramic pieces are studied in their immediate context, that is, in situ, in the soil, and the discovery of the oppositely charged ions made and its effect on nutrient uptake by the root of plants established. In the case of the indigenous practice of making offerings to the spirits of the food field and then breaking ceramic vessels, so in this picture, these are the ceramic vessels that will be broken, and in it is chicha, the pre-Columbian and still used today, corn brew. In the indigenous case, the object, namely ceramic shards, is not separated from a human action in the moment of offering and breaking the vessels, nor at other moments that are echoed in this action, namely the breaking of ceramic vessels at the moment of the death of their maker and burying them alongside her in the earth. These are the immediate echoes of this ritual action, but beyond these, one can discern the echoes with the general theme of the role of decomposition and death in increasing the fertility of the soil. By juxtaposing these two ways of approaching ceramic shards, certain contrasts stand out sharply. The most obvious and startling is how humans are located in each of these procedures. In the scientific case, the humans conduct the investigation but are not organically part of its object of study. The shards and the soil in which they are found are the object, and the scientists studying them are the subject. The scientists' manner of burying their dead, of making ceramics or not, of making middens or manure pile and relating to them or not, are simply irrelevant to the investigation. In the indigenous case, the very presence or raison d'être of ceramic shards has everything to do with the meaning of breaking them at the time of funeral ceremonies, of burying them alongside a dead person, of being made of earth, of echoing the role of decomposition and death in the fertility of the soil. For in the indigenous practice, there is no subject-object separation or dualism. Even formulating it this way seems to force a certain way of looking at things on an enactment where identifying and discriminating subjects and objects is simply irrelevant. There, persons, deaths, funerals, mating and breaking ceramics, the action of microorganisms, the action of the soil, the action of humans, and many more besides, all dance together in a choreography that, like music, yields meaning along with effective results. It is totally possible to consider these two contrasted manners of interacting with ceramic showers as complementary. They are not intrinsically mutually exclusive approaches. I can well imagine a university-educated kitchenista making an offering with ceramic showers while also being perfectly able and interested in carrying out a scientific investigation. Yet, why should the reverse scenario seem more difficult to imagine? Non-indigenous scientists making offerings to the earth spirit with ceramic shards somehow stretches the imagination a little too far. Why? In pondering these two contrasting ways, we must reconsider the beginning of the scientific experimental method as well as its claim to neutrality and universality. Mainstream or classical science, the label classical science is given by scholars in the field of science studies. And it refers to the Cartesian, Boyle, Newtonian paradigm, also known as the billiard ball paradigm. Posits a nature that is completely separate from the world of human generated ideas and things. In other words, from culture. The two terms, culture and nature, co-define each other through exclusion. Nature is what culture is not, and inversely, culture is what nature is not. This way of organizing things has become part of our modern zeitgeist and rather thoroughly pervades every corner of our modernized Western consciousness. From this point of view, indigenous people seeing and addressing spirits or other such non-empirical beings in nature appears exotic, quaint, or primitive, the result of acts of anthropomorphizing where humans project onto the non-human world characteristics of their own cultural world. Those spirits, deities, ghosts, ancestors, or what have you, do not really exist out there, but rather are clumsy pre-scientific attempts to explain the nature of the cosmos. Modernized non-indigenous people tend to categorize such beings as supernatural, that is, beings that do not exist in nature, but in a realm above nature, the same realm where one locates God, angels, and the like. The neat parceling out of what is imaginary and what is real owes a great deal, of course, to the ideas of 17th century French philosopher René Descartes, who more than anyone laid the philosophical basis for the scientific revolution. He was writing at the beginning of the 17th century. So the scientific revolution is usually dated from with Copernicus, mid-16th century, to Principia Mathematica in 1784, thereabout, by Newton. So this century and a half, 1617. And René Descartes, who more than anyone led the physical, with his utter separation between the mind, the res cogitans, and the body, and the rest of the supposedly strictly material world, the res extensa, Descartes fashioned a dualistic worldview parallel and related to the dualism between nature and culture. This parceling out also owes a great deal to the inventor of the experimental scientific method, Robert Boyle. By mid-17th century, when Boyle was making his experiments with the air pump in his public laboratory, the occult philosophers, such as alchemists, hermeticists, Kabbalists, and others, who pursued the experiments alone in secret cabinets, had been tainted by the same brush, inquisitorial brush, that was exterminating the so-called witches, who were actually shamanesses and shamans, European ones. Boyle's past as an alchemist was a clear and imminent danger, and it had to be transformed into something clearly different, although at the same time related. Faced by Catholic and Protestant inquisitions set on hounding out the occult philosophers and the witches, Bohr's new aircraft experiment had to clearly distance themselves from his shady alchemical past. This involved many things, but our concern here is his mighty labors at defining as strictly and as clearly as possible what an empirical event or object is and what is not an empirical object or event. So now I focus on the boundary, the invention of the boundary between the physical and the metaphysical. The mid-17th century, when Boyle was carrying out his experiments in the public lab, public to clearly differentiate it from the occult philosopher's private cabinet, had just emerged from a devastating and lengthy international war known as the 30 Years' War, where the conflict between Protestants and Catholics became an international conflict. In that war, some 35% of Europe's population perished. The 16th century saw a series of bloody and brutal civil wars in France, some 8 of them as well. So we can say that war, chaos, and bloodshed were the immediate context of Boyle's new phenomenon of the public lab for some century and a half previous. Boyle carefully protected this new space from the conflicts raging outside by absolutely forbidding discussions of religion or politics in that space. The metaphysics, and I'm relying on crucial historiography on the scientific revolution, especially the work, the book by Shapin and Schaefer, Leviathan, Boyle and the Experiment of Life, or something like that, and other, Elizabeth Potter, Gender and Boyle's Law of Gases, particularly. The metaphysical, central to the conflict between Protestants and Catholics, had no place in this new space of the public laboratory. And the other thing that had no space were women. Women were explicitly excluded. Even Boyle's sister, an aristocrat, who gave money, but she couldn't participate. And this lasted until well into the 20th century, by the way. So say thank you to your mothers and grandmothers. You women in the room. This was crucial to the aim underlying this new space and the practices that took place within it, namely to re-establish certainty. Certainty had been shattered in these conflicts, and the prevalent view was that without certainty, law and order could not be reinstated. To Boyle's dismay, the metaphysical suddenly made its appearance within this protected new space, raising the specter of irresolvable conflict in this new protected space of the lab. The manner in which what Boyle tried so hard to exclude from his lab made its appearance within it came from a dispute about what the educated gentlemen gathered therein believed to have happened in one of the experiments. Boyle's experimental apparatus consisted in this, the first one. Okay? So it's crucial to know a little bit about it. Consisted of an air pump, like a bicycle air pump, that could take the air out of a glass put on top of it. Once the air pump had seemingly taken all the air out of the glass globe, that is, you couldn't pull it anymore, evidenced by the fact that the pump could no longer be activated, the natural philosophers, that's what they were called. Later they became called simply scientists. Gathered in the public lab, disagreed about what was inside the glass globe. This disagreement was known as the one between the vacuists and the plenists. Vacuists asserted that with the pump, when the pump had taken all the air out of the glass globe at top of it, there remained nothing on it. It was a vacuum. Plenists asserted that there remained in the globe an extremely subtle substance named ether that filled the glass globe but was invisible. Boyle cut the Gordian knot by asserting that he could not pronounce upon what might remain or not in the glass globe after emptying it out of air, since that question could not be resolved experimentally. He therefore declared it to be metaphysical. outside the bounds of what soon came to be known as the scientific experimental method and of science more generally. Boyle's resolution of this dispute went viral, as it were, and soon led to the wholly intended view that whatever could not be established experimentally to exist in the public space of the lab simply did not exist in nature. However, Boyle could not prove in any way whatsoever that there did not exist some invisible, extremely subtle substance in the globe after all the air was pumped out, and he openly acknowledged that fact. His declaring that this was a metaphysical issue that had no place in his lab was a move totally motivated by his intense desire to at once protect his space from conflict and also his desire to re-establish certainty on a wholly new, metaphysically free basis. This little-known historic episode set the stage for late developments where a tacit agreement between the domains of religion and that of science solidified. Religion could claim authority over people's belief and inner lives. But science had authority over nature, a nature completely cleansed of any trace of anything remotely metaphysical. This dividing up of the turf into what a contemporary scientist, namely, has named non-overlapping magisteria, or noma, was a diplomatic, and this the scientist is Stephen Jay Gould, very famous natural historian, was a diplomatic and safe way of diffusing the potential tensions between those two domains. In the new dispensation, the supernatural, considered to be non-empirical entities, were consigned to a non-material, purely metaphysical or religious domain. Exciting revisionist historical work on Boyle has shown that Boyle's boundary between something that was permitted in the new science, namely that was experimentally verifiable, and something that was excluded, which he named metaphysical, was not an act that emerged automatically from experimental practice. It was a deliberate decision on his part, one that had everything to do with the acrimonious debate, even conflict, between vacuists and planists within the lab. In other words, it was at heart a political decision in order to protect his new space, the public laboratory, from the conflicts that raged outside of it. Boyle's boundary making between what is empirically verifiable and what he deemed metaphysical was in fact a contingent and political move. Recent scholarship on the birth of the scientific experimental method, especially the work of Chapin and Schaefer and Elizabeth Potter, breaks with the canonical history of science that simply views these developments as brilliant discoveries by brilliant, upper-class, educated European white men. What emerges from this new scholarship is the contingent, even arbitrary, nature of Boyle's decisions. To the conflicts between Protestants and Catholics must be added what the feminist historians call the burning times, with the extermination of the witches and the persecution of the occult philosophers. In these extremely turbulent and precarious times, when the church's monopoly on education and knowledge was profoundly challenged, Boyle's brilliance was his ability to create a neutral space in the lab where talk of religion and politics was strictly forbidden. It was crucial to the success of his endeavor that his budding experimental scientific method allowed disagreement in the lab over what had actually happened in the experiment, a decision crucial to the robustness of the findings, as well as one that avoided the dogmatism of many church pronouncements, but keep disagreements strictly within the bounds of the neutral space of the lab. Additionally, these permitted and even encouraged disagreements could only belong to a neutral domain, that of nature, a nature that needed to be thoroughly cleansed from any potentially divisive and thus dangerous elements, which Boyle quite arbitrarily labeled metaphysical. If there was to be agreement about a fact, and with it about truth, it needed to be built on a foundation that could be totally separated and protected from those domains where conflicts rage, the ones where the metaphysical was central. Boyle worked very hard to make his experimental method the one everybody agreed upon. This general agreement did not happen quickly or easily. He was challenged on several fronts, and the final defeat of rival methods took close to a century. But this method soon enough won out and has dominated the scientific and cultural scene down to our days. For example, in Stephen Jay Gould's NOMA principle of non-overlapping magisteria between science and religion, we have the direct and contemporary manifestation of Boyle's decision. Adherence to the idea of a sterilized, purified, and purely material nature, where only empirically verifiable objects and events have their being, is still very much with us, as the example of the great difficulty in imagining non-indigenous scientists making offerings of ceramic shards to the spirits of the earth. Yet, once the historical background of the Western modern scientific method is made visible, we can understand there is no inherent reason for these two approaches to be mutually exclusive. All the major institutions of modern society are still based on the old classical scientific worldview. And here there's a lot of scholarship that I refer to, principally the work of the French philosopher Bruno Latour. One that gives certainty and power over the non-human world and, crucially, all those humans perceived as being closer to it, namely all women, lower class, non-educated white men, and all men of color. So all those institutions are not going to welcome with open arms the kind of news some scientists are bringing us lately. I have particularly used the work of a quantum physicist, Karen Barad, who has worked on Niels Bohr physics philosophy papers and his complementary principle. The reaction is what the neo-Jungian psychologist James Hillman calls collective ego defenses of the repressed unconscious of modernity. Modernity, Western modernity, is still overwhelmingly in the grip of this dead world, which is also deadening. The deadening pathological world. Pathology, one of the evidence of this pathology, there are many, is today 10 million of species of plants and animals have been severely diminished, with the largest extinction of species since the disappearance of the dinosaurs, and one caused by humans, giving our geologic era the label of the Anthropocene. We are all in deep mourning, depressed and bereft, whether we are aware of it or of its deep-lying causes, or whether we have repressed all of this to our collective unconscious. I work on several scholars who see the epidemic of drug addiction, especially the late spike with the opioid epidemic, which is ravaging all 50 states in the US and is killing more people than car accidents and homicides and suicides. It's really bad. So the cosmologist Brian Swim points out that the dry, rational, abstract language pervading classical science cannot lead us to change our everyday behavior. Facts by themselves are not enough. What is needed is embodiment. And this is him speaking. What we need is just a simple recognition that as we deprive ourselves and our children of direct contact with the numinous powers that fill the universe, we are choosing a diminished existence. The indigenous and mestizo context in which we were at my center, Sachamama Center for Biocultural Regeneration, where shamanism is vibrantly alive and where thousands of medicinal plants grow, is particularly propitious for fostering both what I name in integral ecology, that is an ecology where the human world and the non-human world are one, are integrated, and also a lived, embodied spirituality. I have come recently, I have focused my work for these past 7 years on healing the earth, and fulfilling a request by the leaders of the Kichwanistas. But I have come to realize that the illness of the people of the north in particular has reached such an acute proportion, and it's reflected in the students that come to me. Not the UVic students are unbelievably healthy. But then I had a group of 15 after you, and I was another kettle of fish. It was stunning, shall I say. So that what I realized, prompted by the spirits in my ayahuasca sessions, I've been doing ayahuasca, participating in the sacred ceremony for 23 years, that the ecological crisis and the mental health crisis, the human crisis, health crisis, come from the same source. So I have decided that my center from now on will be dedicated to both, to healing the earth, as I've been doing, but trying to heal. And it couldn't be a better place because of the vibrant liveliness of shamanism. Of course, one has to be very careful because now shamanism has become very chic in the north and has given rise to charlatans who do it for money. But of course, having been there for 23 years, I know the real ones from the fake ones. And so I intend to do this very, very thoroughly, very well, very carefully. But I've decided you can no longer separate the things. And we have acquired a new piece of land in the forest where we're growing hundreds, if not thousands, of plants, including ayahuasca, and hope in the future to be able to attend both to the healing of the earth and the healing of the